James chapter 1 and verse 23. Now, last week we started a conversation on the... The real crux of it was that we said that we should never make the mistake. We should not make the mistake of believing and confessing, that is, putting our trust in God for something and demonstrating that trust by us declaring and confessing those things without us constantly making, without constant eye contact with the scriptures that promise them. That is, don't make the mistake of believing and confessing for things without constant eye contact with the scriptures that provide us the, or with the, provide us with the evidence of that particular promise from God. We spoke about the fact that it is imperative that we steadfastly behold and look at and read and reread the evidence that God has provided in the Word of God for what we are believing God for. That if we are declaring the Word of God and we switch on the engine of our faith with our confessions, but we don't constantly make eye contact with the scriptures that promise us that, our eyes will be forced to behold that which is natural, and that will create certain emotional reactions on the inside of us that will put a stop to the power of God that is already in operation. But that as we constantly read and reread the evidence, we will, every time we make eye contact with it, get fresh insight, and this will be the game changer. That Proverbs chapter 4 tells us, "My son, attend unto my words and incline thine ear unto my sayings." Right? I put this up on social media, two things are required to have a demonstration of God's power in your life: moving lips and seeing eyes. Someone said to me, "What about ears that hear?" And I said, "You cannot," which means, what about the hearing part? I said, "You cannot be speaking the word of God without hearing the word of God." All right? There is no way a person will speak words. Now, if I speak to you, you might not listen. So we can say you do not hear. But words that come in out of your mouth, the way we are wired, is that they go straight into your inner ears, and so you hear them. That in fact, when the Bible says, "My son, attend to my words and incline their ear unto my sayings," that inclination comes as the words come out of your own lips. So we said you've got to make constant eye contact, visual contact with it. Failure to do that, then, is the boisterous wind your eyes will be focused upon. And when that happens, because if you are not looking at the things that are not seen, then the default mode is to look at the things that are seen. And when you look at something, it affects and influences you. And so the Bible says, attend, incline your ear, let them not depart out of your eyes. Two things are required to make a successful faith work: mouth, a mouth that speaks, and we said eyes that also see. Now quickly let me run through some scriptures here to give some footing to what I just said here. If we look at James 1 here and verse 23, it tells us something. James chapter 1 and verse 20, from verse 21. "Wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word." So note this, receive what has already been engrafted. The engrafted word, receive it with meekness, which is able to save your souls. And said, be ye not, but be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own self. For if any man be a hearer of the word, so that's your first encounter with the word, you hear the word. And it says, don't be a hearer only. That's the first step. That's your first relationship with the word. It tells us there in Hebrews, it says, the word that was preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. So the only thing they did was to hear it. They didn't take the next step. So if you are a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man, which means a man who is a hearer, that beholds his natural face in a glass, for he beholdeth himself, and then goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man that he is. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty. So for you to become a doer, you move from just hearing and you start looking. Whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, that is, in the practice of looking. Bible says, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. So we see that he's doing the work. Doing the work is not to try to produce the word of God in his life. God is the aggressor there. The work is to constantly expose his eyes to the evidence of God's word. And when you constantly expose and make visual contact, as the Bible tells us, with an open face, you behold, as you, though you are looking into a mirror. What does it mean with an open face? An open face is a face which means eyes that have been opened. That is, you've got revelation on that subject. You've heard God on that subject. Now you go further and you now behold, right? Looketh into. Bible with an open face beholds, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image, not, all right, by the Spirit of God. So the Spirit of God is the one that does the change and the transformation. He is the one that transforms the person. He is the aggressor. He is the one that administers virtue and power and brings about a reformation in the life of the person. The work of that person is to constantly, and it's work, all right, to behold, constantly look into the word of God and make visual contact with it. But he can't change himself. It's the Spirit of God that actually changes, all right, you as a person. So you sit and behold, and then the Spirit transforms you into the image of what you are seeing. So he tells us that if our gospel be hid, is he to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded their minds, that believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel, who is the image of God, should shine. So we can see that when you have what is called an open face, it means, all right, the light of the word of God has shone into your heart concerning that thing. So you can see the image of God there. And it says, you are beholding that image, you will be transformed into it from one level of glory to another level of glory. So the starting point is about hearing. Then you must go to a place where there is that constant visual contact, eye contact with the word of God. All right? Visual contact with God's word. And so the transformation begins in our lives as we look. Peter tells us we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. He said, eyewitnesses of his majesty when there came such a voice. So a voice came, but they said, we are witnessing to what we saw. So the voice produced some visuals. And it's that the visuals, that's what we looked upon, and that's what we're coming to tell you. So it tells us to receive word that is already engrafted in order to save our souls. And today I want to talk about this issue of receiving this word into our lives there. Receiving the word of God that is engrafted and the process of doing that where we look at this constant eye contact. But first of all, let me establish something that God's basic ingredients in our lives are our needs, which means when God wants to move in the life of a person, the ingredients that God needs is that personal needs exist in the life of that person. A failure to understand this is we will try to hide these needs, we won't understand what's going on, we'll think it is God that hasn't been faithful to us. But Paul came to realize this, and he said, I now take pleasure in my necessities. For he understood that the basic ingredient that God requires is your need. So the needs that you have now, where you are seated, all right, that's where God is going to move into your life. That's the space he's coming into, and that's how he's going to reveal himself within you. Without personal needs, we will get nowhere in our Christian walk. The soul never imbibes truth in its living power, but as it requires it, as those needs are there. We've got to understand that wisdom and philosophy, if we look at God in the context outside our needs there, then people are going to go into enticing words of man's wisdom, doctrines that are built, all right, just on philosophy and all of that, and it won't be the revelation of God's glory. Philosophy and wisdom, human wisdom, never found out God. God makes himself known through our needs. Read through the scriptures, the gospels. Jesus said, I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of the Father. So anything that I'm doing is the Father's will. So even if I'm not around and you want to find out what the Father will do, just look at what I did. And Jesus, when he walked into any person's life, he spoke to that person and ministered to that person in the context of their present need. That's how he addressed. Read the Gospels. He did not go to meet people outside the present needs in their lives. That's how he started out. The Roman centurion, there was a need in his life. His servant was not doing well. The woman with the issue of blood, there was a present need in her life. She had spent all her money on it, and it was still there. And Jesus ministered in the context of that. We also have them that toiled all night and caught nothing. All right, and that's what the Pharisees were agitating against. Jesus was meeting the needs of people, and they were talking about philosophy and all these things, that you are doing it on the Sabbath day, and Jesus was just commonsensical about it. He said, if your ox falls into the well there, what are you going to do? And there is a need there. They said, we are going to move according. So that's what I'm doing here. All right, tell them I open the eyes of the blind. Tell them I raise the dead. Tell them I, heal the deaf. Tell them I cast out devils. Tell them that this is what I'm doing, coming in the context. So they toiled all night and caught nothing. And Jesus coming into their lives was coming in the context of that need. That is, I'm going to address this need that is in the lives of these people. And he did address that particular need there. It was a business need. He addressed it, and they came into an abundance. And then he moved to something else, as we will see. But it comes in the context of the needs there. So it's important to understand that we cannot force truth on people. Right? You minister truth according that addresses the needs in the lives of people. And we can see this pattern. I'm going somewhere with this in Hebrews chapter 2 here. If we just flip back to Hebrews chapter 2, we'll see a pattern here. And what we'll see is verse 6. And we'll see that in one certain place, Hebrews 2 and verse 6, right, testified saying, what is man that thou art mindful of him? To be mindful of a person is to have your mind full of the person. All right, where my mind went to is people are mindful of people, maybe they're falling in love. All right? Like one dear sister, she's in this service. She was putting up all her poems she used to write back then in 2000. Okay? She put it up on public space. I didn't say it. She put it there. And it's about how she will love, how much she loved people. But the poem talked about being mindful. When I wake up in the morning, do you get what I'm saying? When I sleep at night. So God is in love with you. That's what I'm saying. Do you get what I'm saying? His mind is full of you. You say, great, great. Since God's mind is full of me, I will go higher, higher, every day higher, from glory to glory. But let's look at his pattern. Mindful of you, what is man that thou art mindful of him? Or the son of man that you did what? Visited him. So he comes to visit you. Sorry, sir. When God visits, thou made him what? A little lower. Once God steps into your life, he says, you go down in order to be triggered up. I bring you out of Egypt's wilderness. It seemed a little lower, but it's to propel you to a particular place. So he made him a little lower than angels and then crowned him with glory and honor and did set him over the works of his hands and put all things in subjection under him. Verse 9, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, now crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. For it became him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make their captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. And then it goes on in verse 14. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also likewise took part of the same, that through death, that tasting of it, he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and then deliver them who through the fear of death were kept a long life, lifetime in bondage. So what does God say here? Personal needs come into our lives. God says, I want you to taste of this, that you have this need, inadequacy here, to taste of it, all right? And for you to understand that, yes, you might be made a little lower, there's this need here, and it seems like you made a little lower here, for the sufferings there of death. He said, but understand, you are going to be crowned with glory and honor out of this all. That the reason is that when you taste of this, I want you, like Jesus, to destroy him that had the power of death, that is Satan. The word destroy doesn't mean to annihilate, which means cease to exist, but it means to render inoperative, all right, Satan that had the power of death. And then through your own experience, to deliver them who through the fear of that situation have been held in bondage. So you go through things in life. Number one, he says the outcome is that you are going to be crowned with glory and honor, which is, and you are going to be set in a place of dominion, authority, and power. But deeper than that, you are now also going to be in a place where you will be able to set at liberty people that are going through similar things in their lives, all right? And they are in bondage there to fear, not thinking that they can ever come out of it. You'll be able to speak words to people. You'll be able to go out and minister from your own personal experience. As they said, through the knowledge my righteous servant shall receive, he will justify many. You will get in and begin to speak into situations in the lives of people. As you talk about, you know, the word of God coming out of that place, what you experienced, people will be getting liberated, all right, in their own lives there. You are not just speaking from a place of knowledge, you are speaking from a place of skill. There's a difference between knowledge and skill. You can get the knowledge on how to fly by going into a class, but you only get the skill on flying, all right, acquire that skill by practice. The Bible says, they who through reason of use, strong meat belongeth to them, who by reason of use, all right, have their senses developed. And it says they are skillful in the word of righteousness. That skill came as a result of practicing the word of God. So they speak from a place of skill. So you that are believing God for something, as you begin to listen to a skillful person, you begin to see the areas, all right, where you've got to make the adjustment. They speak into the lives of people. They speak from their own experience. And that's where ministry comes from. It comes from. So they toiled all night and caught nothing. It's the pattern of Jesus. He comes in. They catch an abundance. Then he says, now let us go and catch men. I want you now to speak about this to men and bring men in based on, all right, this experience that you have had with me. So God allows you to go through things because he knows there are multitudes that are going through it. He says, you will, by the grace of God here, destroy him that had the power of death in that situation. Come out with the light of God in that place. Broadcast that light into the earth and set people at liberty that were bound. For example, Billy Graham gave probably the best illustration I've ever heard as to why Jesus had to come and God had to come in flesh. He said, if you have a maze somewhere and you have a small ant there, and the ant is trying to find its way out of this maze, it keeps going, and there's, you know, sugar, right? It's trying to going. He can't find going round. Now, if you are compassionate as a man to that ant, and you decide to help the ant, what you will do is that you will try to use your finger to guide the ant. However, the minute your finger appears on the scene, the ant gets scared and runs away. So God says, if I come the way I am into man's affairs, the last time I did that, they said, stay on the mountain. We are okay where we are. So terrible was that sight. All right? The whole thing said, we are okay. All right? Moses, you go alone. He said, if I come that way, if I appear, people will just take off instead of coming towards me. So what I did was to come in flesh and blood. All right? And Jesus came. So the ant now comes. You send another ant that knows the way into the maze. That ant comes and meets with that other ant and then communicates and guides it out. So God says, this is what I've got to do here. All right? People are going through things. God comes in to you and visits you. A little lower, you have that experience. All right? And then he crowns you with glory and with honor. And then you can now go out, right? And people can see the scriptures in your life and can see the way out of their own situation. They can observe you and know the maneuvers they ought to make in order to get out and to enter into the place that God himself has designed for them in life. So we go through things, all right? Number one, God will reveal his glory in our lives. But the purpose of this thing is not just for us to enjoy the glory of God, but now to minister to humanity that are held in bondage to those particular types of situations and get out. That's the meaning of the needs that come into our life. God will show himself forth, manifest his glory, and then from there, all right, he will minister through us, all right, that particular thing. So what we've got to understand when these needs arise in our lives, understand is that God is going to reveal. He's going to bring forth his glory, all right, right through this particular place. But when these needs arise in our lives, what do we do, all right, with the needs? You say, well, I have a need right now. What do I do with the needs? To walk by faith, all right, is to see two essentials. The first is to understand that you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And then number two is to become aware of your need for that blessing. So what happens that God has blessed you with certain things in Christ Jesus. When needs arise in your life, God says, I want you now to become aware of your need for these blessings that I have given to you in Christ Jesus. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3 says God has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. All spiritual blessings, but they are in spiritual forms. In other words, God has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly. Everything, all right, that you can be blessed with. God has blessed you with it in Christ, but these things are in their spiritual forms there. So there are two things. In order to walk by faith, number one, I have been blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. But my life will continue in this place of rest or uniform motion unless I'm compelled by an external force to act otherwise. In other words, when Satan comes and means it for evil, God uses it for his glory. So something happens on the outside that now brings you into an awareness. This is what's happening, of your need for these blessings that God has given to us in Christ. If you run over your mind and you can find one single blessing with which God has not blessed us today, right, that he has not already blessed us with, then what Paul said is inaccurate. And therefore what that means is that what he said is false. And so you can call into question all the letters that Paul wrote, and that is the New Testament. But God has blessed us with all spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So you come to a point in your career, God says, I have blessed you beyond this particular level. So what happens is, in order to get your attention to this blessing, or else you just continue your life in your comfort zone, men resist change. Jesus himself said, there is no man that you will give him new wine, he will say the old wine is better. Men do not like change. We are creatures of habit and we will stay in that state. That's why there is a physical law that says that you will continue in a state of rest, all right? You will continue there unless you are compelled by an external force to act otherwise. Are you following what I'm saying here? Right? So the pressure there begins to come in. So anytime there is pressure, all right, on the outside, anytime there's movement on the outside, understand is that God says there is something in the inheritance that I've blessed you with that should come into your life right now. So in your career, God says now, in my plan, this is the blessing that comes into your life. But you're not aware of it. You say, well, I'm fairly well paid. I'm doing well and all of that. God says, look, we've got to rock this boat here. We've got to rock this boat here. So the agitation starts here. Things begin to, once you see the movement, their needs are created, understand that the only reason why a born-again Christian will have needs is that God says, I want to crown you with fresh glory and honor. Do you understand this? I want to bring you to a new place of honor. Don't despise the needs. Don't get scared about them. This is the process of God through which you will get into, all right, the next level. It's a law. I've spoken about this several times in this church. In Johns Hopkins University, they conducted an experiment. They wanted to find out how these insects, the process of death through these insects. So they put them under this microscopic lens here to observe what will happen when they do not have any food again. They put all of these small creeping creatures, they said, inside, all right, this massive thing, like a massive beaker, and then put a potted plant there and began to observe them. And what they noticed was that they were feeding on the potted plant. They knew it would finish after some time. And so when they ate it all up, they said, all right, let us study the death process now to see how they will die. But as they were examining them, they realized that they had been looking at these insects for years and decades. They didn't know they had this quality. But the minute they were confronted with death and there was no way out, they saw metamorphosis that occurred. These insects began to grow wings. And when they developed wings, flew out of the beaker there and went to another plant somewhere and began to feed on it. Which means that you will not know that you have wings until pressure comes. Are you following what I'm saying? That's why we are pressed on every side. It is pressure that produces power. The treasure that is inside you requires pressure in order for the power of God to come forth. So don't ever get irritated at the pressure. Don't ever get angry that something uncomfortable happened. Don't ever get upset that your landlord says, oh boy, 6 more months, I'm selling this house, breaking it down, you are out of this place. You have been living there, it's your comfort zone. Close to your children's school, close to your office, close everywhere. Suddenly you're about to destabilize this entire life here. Yeah. God says, listen, there's some other place for you, all right? Some other thing that I have for you, right, that I've blessed you with. It's time for it to come into your life. Now, the great pity, somebody said, is that we keep saying, God bless me when we're in situations, God bless me. He has already blessed us with every spiritual blessings in heavenly places, every blessing in the spirit realm, in spirit forms, all right? What we needed to understand is how to appropriate these things. The word appropriate means to set for our practical possession that which already belongs to us in Christ Jesus. And it starts out with this need. Look at Hebrews chapter 11. Just flip there and look at verse 3. This is what we're talking about. It says, through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things that are seen were made of things, not out of nothing, but were made of things that do not appear. In other words, God has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Those things are in their spiritual form. But we need to understand that through faith, God, the scripture tells us, through faith you understand the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things that are seen were made out of their spiritual forms that were in existence. So these things were in existence in their spiritual forms. And God made them out of those forms. And so when he blesses us with every spiritual blessing, he says, what I will do to you is that I will send my word to you that will give you information about my blessing, all right? And you are going to frame that word in your life. This is what you're going to do. That the worlds were framed by the word of God. You are going to frame that word I give to you in your own life, so that people will now be able to see the picture of that word in your own life as a person. When they look at your life, they see the word framed in your life. So the things that are seen were made out of things that do not appear. So God blesses us in spiritual forms, and he says, now you need to now enter into this. Now, what many of us do, all right, is that when God gives us his word, we admire the word, we talk about the word, right? But we do not realize this, that we will need to appropriate this word into our lives when needs begin to arise. We just don't get that. That God sends his word to us, we admire the word, we can even teach it, but we don't understand that the purpose of this word is to appropriate and to frame this word into our lives. So when needs arise, we have gotten into the critical phase, which is the key to it all. A person gets taught, God is your healer, Jehovah Rapha. When the symptom comes, the critical phase has now come, the key to it all. You have got to move, this is what I want us to get, truth, from a place where you have accepted it to a place where you have now received it into your life. You see, what we don't get is that the soul will only imbibe truth in its living power as it requires it, or else it stores it in its memory, accepts it, and just simply stores it there. And when it's stored there, you can use it, you can preach it, you can explain it, but it is not yet operational in your life. It is not inside, all right, your life as a person. You haven't received it. How do we know this? James said, receive with meekness the engrafted word of God, which means the word has been engrafted, but you receive it. Now, we've accepted it. We mentally assent to it. We can talk about it. We admire it. But you know what happens? Because we know it mentally, what we say to God is that because I know these things, this other thing should not happen to me. I shouldn't have any need. This is what we say. That because I know that God will supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory, then the truth about the matter is that I shouldn't have any need. That listen, when they say, you don't have any need, say yes, because God has supplied my need according to his riches and glory. What is when the need arises that we get to the critical phase? When those need arise that we have now the key to it all. The real place here where we can move it from just mental acceptance to a place where, all right, we receive it into our lives. When you accept something mentally, you can talk about it, right? You can teach it. Don't forget that Paul said, I taught these things, right? Okay, I taught these things, but I could be a castaway myself, which means I could miss it, even though I taught and I explained these things. If you read Job, can you quickly put this up? Job chapter 4, all right? It says from verse 3, behold, thou hast instructed many, okay? And thou hast strengthened weak hands. Look at this. And then he says, thy words have upholding him that was falling, and thou hast strengthened the feeble knees. But now it is come upon thee, and thou faintest. It toucheth thee, and you are troubled. You have shared the word. When somebody else was going through it, you went there to share it. But now it has touched you. That means that what you are sharing wasn't in you. What you are sharing wasn't part of your, all right, existence and life. It had not been integrated into your being. It was just something you knew mentally, which you can acquire, you know, by reading. Skill comes by transferring it from the place of mental assent to the place where you receive it. That's why in the process of receiving the word of God, you must continuously make eye contact with the truth that you already know. When you're just talking about knowledge, that's when people will come and say, all right, oh, this message I heard, for example, all right, ministers get under pressure and they want to preach new things every time so that they don't say that, you know, I have a fresh word. You say fresh word, fresh manna from heaven. The manna was the same, whether it was fresh. Do you get what I'm saying? Fresh word. All right, fresh word from heaven. So he starts preaching. After some time, he gets out of the context of the needs of the people and he's just preaching doctrines there because he wants to say something new. All right? I remember Kenneth Hagin saying once, said, preacher, must never, pastors, he said, never ever get to the point where you're pressured and you always want to come up with something new. Say the same thing. Say it over and over. Kenneth Copeland a few weeks ago was saying this. A friend showed me this. He said, listen, I listened to one message of Kenneth Hagin. He said, I was in the conference. I had to ask myself and I sat down in this place. I was there. You mean I was there when this man was preaching this? He said he made his decision about 3 weeks ago at the age of 80 to go back and listen to all the Kenneth Hagin messages I've been listening from the 70s. All right? He said because there was something. What was it he was talking about? You are getting to the point where you are moving to receiving the word of God. It's not just mentally assenting or accepting. You are now receiving the word of God into your life. Hagin said he went somewhere. All right, he was a pastor and there was a traveling minister that would go around. And while he travels, he will preach and preach and preach. And he will preach the same message. And one young man said, why does this man, every time he comes, he preaches the same message and all of that? But he used to move with a person who also used to sing. And the person who sang would sing the same songs. He said, but this man who was singing sang the same songs. Why didn't you say you should change his songs? Are you following what I'm saying there? You don't come every Sunday night and say, change the song. That we listen to me every day, we're singing new songs. You won't work. You have to sing songs, you know. You have to repeat the songs. The same songs we sang last week, we sing again this week, we sing next week. All right? But let the preacher there preach the same sermon. That's the end of his ministry. Do you understand what I'm saying? All right? That's what's called we want. But look at what Peter said in 2 Peter here. 2 Peter chapter 1. That's why it's with meekness you receive. With meekness. It takes meekness to go back to what has been planted and say, let me look at this again. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 12. Wherefore, I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance. Second Peter, put you in remembrance of these things, though you know them. He said, I'm still putting you in remembrance. And though you be established in the present truth, yea, it is meet. Yea, it is right. Negligence means negligence of duty. All right? If a patient comes to a doctor and he doesn't do the basic things he should do, he can be charged for negligence there and he can be taken to court. A minister must understand you are negligent. There's this word called negligence here, your duty. If you don't put people in remembrance, though they know those things, you are reminding them of it. He said in verse 13, I think it meet as long as I'm in this tabernacle to steer you up by putting you in remembrance. In other words, whatever you know, anytime you go back to it, you get steered up. Do you understand this? Anytime you go to it, you get steered up. No matter what you know, anytime you go to it, you get steered up. You get fired up. You get stirred on the inside. The things you know, you look at them again. That's why I said last week that continuous eye contact will bring fresh insight into what you already know, and that will be the game changer. You get stirred up inside your heart, all right? And having gotten stirred up there, you now want to move into something else. And Peter said here, knowing shortly I must put off my tabernacle, that is physical death here, even as the Lord has shown me, he said, moreover, I will endeavor that you may be able after my disease to have these things always in remembrance. So he wrote them, he said, when I'm gone, keep reading the same thing. He wasn't changing the truth. He said, just you keep reading the same thing. And I dare say this, any truth you have in your life, if you don't constantly listen to the messages that sparked off that truth, if you don't constantly look at the scriptures that planted that truth inside you, that truth has started waning in your life. You are no longer practicing it the way you ought to practice it. Are you following what I'm saying here? If they stop, listen to me, if we teach prayer, and then I don't say anything about prayer in my messages for 3 months, the prayer life of people in church will drop. That's what will happen. If I teach confession and I don't say anything about the spoken word, people will get off it. So you have to constantly say it that they might maintain, put them in remembrance that they might maintain good works, Paul said. So then we start receiving patiently, all right? So when the need arises, we move from acceptance to the place where we receive. Without needs, we simply accept the truth, but we don't receive it into our very beings. We don't become partakers of the nature of God. When we start receiving truth, which means a person starts receiving truth, a person in their business says, listen, I haven't gotten clients now for 3 weeks. It's time to start receiving what I know, that they toiled all night and caught nothing. Let me now receive this truth into my life. It's time to receive it. Not just to accept that Jesus did it and admire it, but to receive it. When we start receiving, we patiently wait on him. During that time, that is necessary for him to walk into our characters and to walk into our lives that which is already ours in Christ. So he is going to walk into our characters and walk into our lives what already belongs to us in Jesus Christ. Now the important thing, this is the crux here, to know is to know and to be sure of this, that all belongs to us in Christ and we are complete in him. In other words, so know with all certainty, if I just lost my job, that I have every spiritual blessing in heavenly places, which means there is something God is going to bring and I'm going to be crowned with honor and glory out of this situation. Now, that fact that it is ours in Christ already, that fact is what makes us hold still, which means when we wait on him, we are still before him while he patiently walks into our character and our lives what we have in Christ Jesus. In other words, we hold still, right? It didn't come after 3 days, but we hold still. No anxiety on the inside of us. We are sure and certain about the outcome. We stay there in stillness, praising him, worshiping him, all right, about this outcome here. Still there, without moving, no anxiety on the inside. It is this stillness that produces power. But let me just quickly say something. I've said this several times, go say it again. What does it mean to be still and you are not agitated about it, even though there's pressure? Okay, you are not agitated. I remember once I was watching American Idols. Many years ago, and I will sit at my office and watch it. And they will start evicting people, and all the great singers, they will evict them. And I will get angry. Almost hit my set. Put off the set. Tell myself I will never again watch this thing. But the next week again, I'm there. But the final deal breaker was the year Fantasia won. It was that year I was watching, and Jennifer Hudson was put up for eviction, Fantasia, and the three that were left couldn't sing for their lives. So I said, what's going on here? I was so angry, I put off the set. And then I was breathing. Then I picked my phone. Now let me call my brother in America. How do you take this, watching on TV, evicting all these people? So I called. Oh, he said, you're watching. He said, good. He said, but it's over now. It ended last night. I said, huh? This delayed broadcast. I said, okay. I said, so who won? My heart was beating. He said, Fantasia. I said, yeah. I quickly put it up. Went back to TV, put it on. All right, let's watch now. I know the outcome. Do you understand what I'm saying? So my heart is still. Even when they hold, Fantasia, you might be next. Hold hands with the next person. And then the sound starts going, bom, my own heart goes killed. So what am I saying? When you know the outcome, no matter what is going on the outside, you are still. Because it's in the place of stillness God can begin to build into you. It's in the place of quietness. Are you following what I'm saying here? God begins to build, all right? And God begins to walk through your life. Look at Joshua chapter 3, quickly, and verse 6. Joshua chapter 3 and verse 6. Joshua 3 and verse 6. All right? It tells us this about Joshua. Joshua spoke unto the priest, saying, take up the ark of the covenant and pass over the people. And he took up the ark of the covenant and went before the people. And then the Lord said unto Joshua, this day will I begin to magnify thee. And you need to understand that you have needs. Everybody knows about your needs. God says, this day I will start magnifying you in the eyes of these people. All right? Well, I just lost my job. This day, God says, I want to magnify you. That when they see you, they hear anything, they say, leave that guy. Leave him. Leave that lady. Leave them. 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 All right? Something is going to come out of this. I've seen them before. I will begin to magnify you in the eyes, all right, of the people. So they took up the ark of the covenant and went. And the Lord said unto Joshua, and then in verse 8, he says, I was Moses, I'll be with you. In verse 8, thou shalt command the priest that bear the ark of the covenant, saying, when you are come into the brink of the water of Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan, which means you are inside the Jordan, which is the waters there that you can feel. These things will drown you. But you are there and you stand in it, knowing the outcome of it, still. And those that bear the ark, David showed us that when you want to carry the ark, it's with singing. So you are there still, knowing the outcome of it in the waters, rejoicing, singing, praising God. But you see, you've got to understand how you get into your promised land. When you are coming out of Egypt, the type of getting born again, Moses was the one. You know what he did? He put up the rod before that. He said, stand still, you see the salvation of God. He put up the rod. The waters parted before they started going into it. So they didn't, it wasn't by faith like that. It's Moses that used his own faith. The waters parted, it was dry. Then they started walking on dry land. God says, this time around, for you to get into your destiny, the waters will not part first. You will enter into the waters. Are you following what I'm saying here? All right? You are not going to sing, all right, when I have given you the finances. You are going to enter into the necessity. Right? And you will be hearing the voices of them coming to collect money from you. That's the water on your feet. Do you understand what I'm saying? Hitting you this way, coming all over there. Now, the challenge is I'm looking at your heart. I want you to be still before me and worship me, and you don't turn to those waters and acknowledge them to be more powerful than me. But start praising me. He said, if you do that, all those waters will reside. You understand what I'm saying? You must be still. And this is where we don't know whether you are still. You can be moving your lips, but we don't know whether you are still. That's why we cannot say why it didn't work for somebody, because we really don't know whether you are still inside your heart. So he says this here. All right, Joshua, verse 9, call the children, come hither, hear the words of the Lord. Joshua said, hereby shall you know the living God is among you, and that he will without fail drive out before you the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, and all the Hittites. Behold, the ark of the covenant of the earth passeth over before you Jordan here. Therefore take 12 men, and it shall come to pass, verse 13, as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that bear the ark, which means those that are praising and rejoicing, right, rest in the waters of the Jordan, the waters will be cut off. And verse 17, the priests that bear the ark of the covenant stood firm on dry ground. Okay? in the midst of the Jordan, all the Israelites passed on dry ground. So they entered into it, put their feet there, praising and worshiping God, and then it parted. And then as they stood in those waters, the flow continued until every single person, right, had gone over. So what God wants is to get to this place of stillness. This is the challenge here. In the waters there. All right? Stand still and you shall see the salvation. Don't rush. Okay? When you are believing God and you want to receive, don't rush. Don't say, oh, it must happen now. Oh, this week it must. Oh, then start rushing. Okay? Don't rush. God won't rush. When we get hasty in our spirits, we begin to agitate there. And then we start taking other options and it hinders the work of the Spirit. All right, when you begin to agitate, you can't rush the process. Just get there and be still. You will see the wonders of God. Okay? If a farmer plants the seed, a farmer cannot agitate. That it has done, the farmer has done what he can do. He leaves the seed there and allows the process. And he goes to sleep and he rises. All right, night and day. If it begins to get agitated, right? That's why a lot of people start getting agitated about their business. Let me tell you, just stay in the place of worship. Stay there in the place, acknowledging the promises of God. Next, look at it. Worshiping and acknowledging in stillness. What will happen is as the flower blossoms and opens up, your life will begin to open up. God will just show you what to do as an idea. And you just do it. You don't even think you are doing something massive. You carry out that idea and bam, things happen. It blossoms. When you start agitating, people start, you know, trying to, what I did last year, let me repeat and double it. All right? Just stay there in worship and taste of the Lord. Enter into the reality of that particular thing. Worship Him. All right? He says, the Lord will bless us and the earth will yield its increase when we praise Him. So what happens to the person when you start praising? God's method. All right, you wake up one morning and you don't know it's your morning of powerful visitation. Okay, the same way David was sent on an errand. It wasn't David that said, I'm going to become chief of staff. He was sent on an errand. Maybe in the office, they just send you on an errand. Right, and you get on that errand to go and deliver it. There, you are going to Abuja. All right, Joseph, when he woke up in the morning, did not know that he was going to be prime minister by the end of the day. But you are there, stillness. When he was agitating, you could still, that movement was there. He was still in jail, telling the chief butler, can you go and help me? Can you help me to do this? Can you help me to do this? All right? But get into the place of worship, all right? And you will start seeing things deeper. So God, just get there and be still before Him. But that's where the real key is, to be still. If you're in a hurry, reality will never come. Ask yourself, have I been hasty in my spirit concerning this? When appropriating for a practical possession, which means setting something aside for a practical possession, we must enter into the required rest. This is the point. Before God can move on our behalf, we get into rest where our heart is free of all anxiety. We know it is done and we are just worshiping Him. We've entered into rest. That's what Paul identified in Abraham as being in a state where he was fully persuaded. That's what he was saying, labor to enter into that rest. When you enter into that rest, you cease from your own works and God begins to carry out activity on your behalf. Our goal is not to seek to manifestation, which means how am I going to get this result? God is the one that will produce that. Our goal is to enter the required rest in our heart, where in spite of the appearances, in spite of our feelings, our heart has now received our confessions as its present reality. That is, our heart has now accepted. We are now quiet. That this is a done deal in my life. We've gotten to that place. It hasn't changed on the outside, but we know it is done. It is then we have arrived at the place of full persuasion. Right? And there, so that our righteousness now, the righteousness which is of God, the righteousness we can call the blessing of God that was imputed unto us in Christ, which means on our behalf, it was imputed unto us in Christ. We now come to the point where it is imparted into our souls and it is now ours. For this to happen, 5 steps must be taken. And one of the steps is constant visual contact with the Word of God. Now, I've got to stop because of time. So I'll just share one more thing before I close. But we need to arrive at this place of quietness. Now, Once you get into that place of rest, you've come into the place of manifestation. The Bible says Jesus promised rest. His rest. That's the promise. He said, lest a promise of entering into his rest. Okay? He said, because they always err in their heart and have not known my way. They never get into rest. What happens is that once they get into another situation and things are not working, they start the agitation. He said they never got into a place of rest. Where they say, God has blessed us with every spirit of God. All right. And they are responsible people, but they are there worshiping. All right. They've entered. Never got there. Five steps must be taken. Okay? From the first ladder of knowledge, that is hearing the word. What does God's word say about this? Then to speaking the language of God using past tense language. This is how we get it into our heart. That's really what brings the rest. Visual contact with the word of God. Praises unto God. And then we enter into the place of undeniable prayers. Let me just quickly touch on one. Close with this. First thing is that Romans 4 says this. I just want to say, I will elaborate on this, but let me just lay the foundation. God quickens the dead. And if you can help me put Psalm 119 and verse 49 and 50. Psalm 119. So the first thing Abraham said is that God quickens the dead, which means I was in a hopeless situation. He quickens you. And how does he do that? Remember thy word unto thy servant. Psalm 1, I said 49 and 50. Remember thy word unto thy servant, upon which thou hast caused me to hope. So the word comes and he says, you gave me hope in a hopeless situation. He said, this has been my comfort in all my affliction. So the word I heard now becomes my comfort. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, the comfort. So it's the word that is going to take me as I'm walking through the valley of the shadow of death, receiving this particular thing in my life, comfort. For thy word has quickened me. So the word, that's how God quickens the dead. He says, by giving you his word. He sends his word and quickens. However, let me just say then the next thing he says is, you should call into existence those things that be not. Or what God does is he calls into existence. The next thing is your language. If you don't speak the same language as somebody, don't let me say it that way. Okay. For you to be in agreement with a person, you must at least speak one same language, or else you won't understand yourself. Okay? That's a better way of saying it. All right? If you go to a foreign land, you can't come into agreement because they are saying something you don't understand. You are saying your own. If you say, let's go left, they might be saying, let's go right. So you must be saying the same thing. And the minute God says, I call into existence those things that be not as they were, he's telling you, put the blessing as an event that happened in your past. Are you following what I'm saying? So if you are believing God for healing, declare it as something that occurred. So you are declaring out of your lips, I remember looking back when I got healed. Now today, all right? So you are talking about being free today because you got healed sometime in the past. You are calling it into existence as though it were. However, we'll elaborate on this tomorrow, on next Sunday. When the Bible says your heart is fully persuaded, it means it can be partially persuaded. You can be double-minded. To be double-minded means one part of your heart is going this way, another part of your heart is going that way. Okay? Double vision. One is seen, is double. So the heart is not united. The Bible says when a man is double-minded, he can't receive. So what he knows, he can't receive it because the heart is. So for the heart to be united, there are four parts in the human heart that must all come together. Number one, your center of logic, which means if you say anything, one part of your brain is where you rationalize things, your logic, right? When you say something, your seat of logic has to process what you have said to see whether what you are saying makes sense. That's why people talk. You say, are you sure you're listening to yourself? Do you listen to what you just said? Did you hear yourself? I don't believe you listened to yourself. Say it again. That your seat of logic should do what? Check you, all right? I was watching one old, I like politics, so I was watching one campaign manager, all right? He changed the whole of America. Just looking at his life, he died of something else. But he was looking at his life, died very early, but he would have changed the whole of America. And I remember, I won't call the name of the person, but he has been a president of America. He was the co-campaign manager. He got up And he just said, well, you know why? This person running for presidency. You know why we want him? You are the co-campaign manager. So this person is running for presidency. You now are talking. You know why we want him to be president? So that he can at least have a real job. Uh-huh. His wife was standing like, she looked, what did you just say? This man, all right? His brother too was there, looked at him. Oh boy, what did you just say? Which means you've said something that logically, right? So, if you confess 2017, my year of release, your center of logic say, eh, okay, wait now. By March, I will have had $10 million in my account. The logic center says, close. What he has just said doesn't make sense. What do you mean? The whole of 2016, 10 million were struggling in Naira. You are saying dollars. Except you have some MMM, you want, okay, no. I just had to. Okay. Now the second one is, so when you say something, logically, all right, unless there's a superior logic that says it can come to pass, the word of God is called the logos, it's called the logic of God. So when you get revelation from God's word, it touches that center of logic. When you say something on the basis of revelation, you say it can happen. Do you get what I'm saying? Okay. Then the next thing is, when you say it, the other part of your heart starts with your imagination, where images are formed. Now, if you say something and it doesn't form an image, that part of your heart doesn't respond to it. In other words, if I tell you I have a red car, I've only sown confusion here, because everybody will just see blood red car, because you don't know what kind of car it is. All right? Until I get specific and I say it's a Volkswagen. Then depending on the way you see things, if you are prosperity mindset, you will see a Passat. If you are poverty, you see a Beetle. But I said I have a red Volkswagen, I didn't say which one. But if you see B2 here, you need a renewal of your mind. Do you understand? So, you see something. But if I say it's a Volkswagen B2, then you see the B2. So, when you say something, an image has to form. So, you can't just make a confession, therefore I believe in 2017, I've broken forth on the left and on the right hand side, my members overflowing with banks. What is overflowing with banks? What's the image? You broke forth on the left and the right. What is break forth? Even if the image is you move from two-bedroom house to owning your house, the heart can understand that. Do you get what we're saying there? So whatever you say, let an image be imprinted inside your heart, which means a specific image. That is, through faith you understand that the worlds were framed by the word, which means frame the word of God. Create an image of that word. Let it be imprinted. The third part is your emotions, which is how you feel. That's why praise is the most powerful form of confession. Because when you are praising and you are rejoicing, you are emotionally expressing that you have that particular thing. Feeling that you have it on the inside of yourself. Thanksgiving, praise, very powerful. The last one was the one God showed me recently. I've been thinking about it for a long time. And what is it? He said, when you make a confession, calling it into existence as though it were, there has to be a description of what you call response of external stimuli. How the people respond to that blessing. It has to be in your confession. If you look at it, Mary said, before she got pregnant, she said, from now on, all nations shall call me blessed. She said how people will respond to that. Sarah said, God has made me to laugh. So all that hear will do what? Laugh. David said, he brought my feet out of the miry clay, set it on a rock to stay. He said, put a new song praise. Many shall see it and put their trust in God. He said, God turned the captivity. What happened? So the heathen round about said, God has done great things for them. The response of people round about you must be your confession. So if you start declaring things, which means, and you start declaring it, you got to say, all right? Whatever it is, even if you just put your parents, how they respond to you. Even if it's just family members, how they respond. Even as Paul said, they gave me the right hand of fellowship. The doors that he opened up, put it there, all right? How people have been encouraged by it, how you that response to external stimuli has got to be part and parcel of your confession. We'll continue next week. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your word, and by the power of your spirit, I ask that you establish us in this truth. Let this principle be established in our hearts and in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Quick announcement.